Nonsense Radio.
Yes, 8:38. It is December 8th. The Immaculate Conception of the Blessed Virgin Mary. If you're Catholic, you gotta go to church today. It's a holy day of obligation.
Yes.
So you gotta go. A lot of people think the Immaculate Conception was the actual conception of, well, people who don't know think it was the conception of Jesus, but that's not what that was. Long story.
We don't have time to get into it right now.
But it's not. It's of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Just let you know, just in case you forgot, ladies and gentlemen, Chris Wallace. Good morning, this morning. Chris Wallace, how you doing, buddy?
I am doing great, and I have got to tell you, I'm going right to the plug, right at the start, because ask me who my guest is going to be this week.
Chris Wallace, I've been wondering, who is going to be your guest on Fox News Sunday?
Donald J. Trump.
Whoa!
We're going up to interview him at Trump Tower, then we're going to get in the motorcade with him, go on Trump Force One, and go to the Army-Navy game with him on Saturday.
Whoa, that's going to be really...
How's that?
That's going to be cool.
Mahalo, Donald Trump.
And, you know, to see him for the first time, I mean, not officially, but in effect in his role as Commander-in-Chief, it's going to be great.
Wow, and that's going to be exciting. I mean, all that going on. I mean, I find it interesting to see how things are turning. He's keeping everybody off balance, not only with his tweets, but also with his decisions. Like, for instance, I was just talking about how on Tuesday or over the weekend, you know, Al Gore visits Trump Tower and everybody's freaking out about how he's going to renege on his promises and he's letting down his base. Then today he picks up a guy.
Scott Pruitt,
yeah.
Attorney General of Oklahoma,
right.
Who's suing the EPA.
Yeah, right.
You know what I'm calling it? And I think I'm going to call the show this, the Trump way, because he is doing everything differently than anybody in my experience, and it goes back a few years, ever has. And it's actually, I was going to say, kind of invigorating for me, because when you've been around Washington a lot, you've seen, I've been here since 1978, so I've seen a bunch of elections and a bunch of new presidents, a bunch of transitions, and you know what to expect. And with this guy, you wake up every day, and you have no idea what to expect. I feel like a Cub reporter again, and it's really kind of exciting.
It is kind of neat. It's like, I don't know whether you all have, you know, the calendars around the holidays, and every day you open up a calendar.
Yeah, the Advent calendar.
The Advent calendar, and you see what is there, and it's kind of like every day is kind of like that. It's been fantastic. Enjoyable. So how does an interview like this how does this happen? Have you been constantly calling the campaign or the his people, or how does this finally come about?
I made myself a thorough pain in the you know what. I mean, I just have been impossible. I have been after them every day since the election, and this was exactly what I wanted. I didn't know about Army Navy, but I wanted to go, you know, do an interview and go with him on the road when he started the thank you tour. And, you know, so it wasn't just an interview, but a working profile of him. And I, when I was told yesterday that I had it, one of the people I was dealing with said, don't ever do that to us again. I said, I'm going to do this every, not every day, but I'm going to do this for 4 years. I mean, I have generally found that if you suffer in silence, you get nothing. You got to make yourself a thorough pain in the neck, which doesn't mean you're going to get it, but certainly improves your chances of getting it.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. And as usual, in all likelihood, there'll be some news coming out of it.
Well, one hopes.
Yeah, I mean, and because Jim,
I would think at this point, almost anything you ask him is going to make news. I mean, EPA is a perfect example and something I am going to talk about. You know, on the one hand, you met with Al Gore and you told the New York Times you had an open mind about climate change, and now you've named this guy. So where are you on the whole issue of climate change and regulation? I just think it's, you know, whatever he says to that is going to be interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I tried to explain that if you do read the Art of the Deal, or for that matter, even Art of War, you see some of these tactics being played out. And they're not dishonest tactics. They're just means of, I mean, I think this is how he has become who he is, and not only as the 45th president, but also as a businessman. You make all kinds of arrangements with people who might have you might not have much in common with, or you might have to deal with. I think the Mitt Romney meeting is like that too. I think it's interesting to watch how he's moving.
Absolutely, I think a lot of it is about leverage. It's about how you get your way, and the idea that you say something in the beginning doesn't mean that that's where you're, where you're going to end up. It's an opening position and leverage. I mean, I think, for instance, the call with the Taiwanese president, President Tsai. As he pointed out in one of his tweets, they don't ask us for permission when they start creating military bases in the South China Sea, and they don't ask us for permission in when they do various things. And this is his way of saying, look, it's going to be different in my presidency, and it's not going to be a one-way street. You want something from us, or we want something from you, we're willing to exact a price if you don't give it to us. So, it'll be interesting to see. We've never seen anything like it. It could work fantastically. Maybe it won't work, but it's sure going to be interesting to cover.
This leverage approach is interesting because anybody who doubted that he would operate that way only need go back to the, I think it was the first debate regarding the pledge. And he used the word leverage when he responded to this question over whether he'd sign a pledge. And he was kind of like, I don't know.
Oh, do you mean the question is whether he would accept the nominee of the party?
Right. Yeah,
the first question that Brett Baer asked, and he wouldn't raise his hand, and he talked about having leverage over the party. Yeah, I mean, I think he views everything as a negotiation, and I want what I want, but I know that you're not going to give it to me of your own free will, so I've got to make it into your interest to give it to you.
Right. I mean, I think that's fascinating. I would be interested to see whether that seems to be a commonality with CEOs. I mean, because a lot of people say, well, that's not leadership, the critics would say, but I think that's what leadership precisely is.
Well, it's a form of leadership, and there are a variety of forms of leadership.
Yes.
You know, Ronald Reagan used to use inspiration and appealing to the public, but in a sense that was leverage too, because he would always in those speeches he would say to the voters at the end of the speech, if he was pushing a policy on the budget or taxes or whatever, he would say, and call your congressman, and the next day there'd be all this talk about how there'd been 100,000 calls and the Capitol switchboard had blown up. So that's a form of leverage too, public leverage.
Are you going to ask him if he is so far accepting the results of the election?
You, my friend, are a dope. Well, you short-circuited. I mean, here's an interesting thing about that. And I must say, and I don't know the folks that you, I know that your listeners are generally conservative, but I'm sure that there are people you know socially who are not like-minded of you. And I mean, do you know people who sneer at the idea of the Trump presidency and what this guy is going to be and what he's going to do to the country? And it's not just an acceptance that, look, one side won, and, you know, last time Obama won, and there were a lot of people who were unhappy with that, and now Trump's won, and people are unhappy about that, and that's the way our political process works. Not everybody's going to be happy every time. Do you find people who are sneering at the idea of a Trump presidency?
My entire family, including my 88-year-old mother.
Yeah,
well, I'm the youngest of six.
You, with all due respect, I hate that.
Well, I mean, listen, I'm not insinuating that they're mean about it. Actually, every single one of my family members is exceedingly nice about it. Although my mom and I had a conversation the other night, and it was just between me and her, and she had a few choice things to say about him. But generally, we had Thanksgiving, and we had, you know, and everything was great, and we had a few side conversations about it. But my family, I'm the only conservative in my family. I'm the youngest of six, including my, and then my mother. And yet my family members, I couldn't love them anymore, and I couldn't see their liberalism as any more as offensive to me at all, because they're different than some of the other people you might find out there. So,
no, but I'm talking about something different. I'm fine with people who don't like Donald Trump,
right,
who are concerned. I mean, I can understand that totally. I don't like people who act like you're an idiot and he's going to be terrible president, and anybody who doesn't think that is a dope. That I don't like.
Right. And we have to watch them and hear them 24/7 in the news media and beyond. And with the exception of yourself and some other choice members of your team, unfortunately, we got to see that in the media, which is disturbing.
No, I agree. I have to say, on election, the day after the election, turning on the TV and watching some of the mainstream media, and some of the anchors looked like their puppy had just died. And, you know, it's a democracy. Your side doesn't always win. You got to respect the fact that I understand more people voted for Clinton than voted for Trump, but that isn't the way the system works. 62.5 million people voted for Trump. Pay them some respect. They're not all, you know, they're not all dopes and yahoos. A lot of them are thoughtful people who felt that we needed to change and that Trump was the right kind of change.
Right on. That's what I've been saying all along,
and I've
brother.
I've been telling you this all along because, you know, you were a doubter and I had to convince you to listen to Trump. All right, folks, for those of you who don't know the joke, Jamie was brought me to the party.
Oh, and believe me, but you were being a journalist. I mean, I'm obviously an opinion guy. So, you know, I told you what was going on, and you were just doing what Chris Wallace has been doing in Washington since 1978. So, I get it.
That's true.
We had a great conversation.
And he teases me about this. Trump does, the fact that I didn't believe he was even going to run. But in fairness to me, he's been toying with this idea since 1988. I interviewed him on the floor of the Republican convention in 1988 about the fact that he had been talking about running. So, you know, it wasn't irrational on my part to think, well, he's been loosey with the football for 20 years. It's going to happen again.
Well, that's why I actually used that soundbite once, because early on, everybody's saying he's not really a Republican. But I goes, baloney. He was there with HW early on. I mean, I know he's had some Democratic tendencies, but I'm just saying, you know, he did help the Republican Party, too. It's not like he's just, like, from out of nowhere.
No, that's true.
So I used that soundbite.
But, you know, I mean, come on. There was plenty of reason to question whether he was going to run for president.
Oh, yeah. Oh, sure. Whether he was going to run? Sure. But once he did, I'm telling you, it was pretty clear what was going to be happening. Well, is this the first time you've been on Trump Airlines?
Oh, yeah. I hate to say it, but I couldn't be more excited. I mean, when I take the shuttle, the regular shuttle to New York, and I land at LaGuardia, and I see Trump Force One out the window because that's where it's parked all the time, I get excited by that. And my kids and I, you know, we'll send pictures to each other, from outside the plane, saying, Trump Force One. And take a ride on it, even only from New York to Baltimore, it's got to be cool.
Yeah, no doubt, man. Well, I can't wait to watch. We'll obviously be there and have fun with it and tell.
You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to probably do used to fly on Air Force One when I was covering Reagan, and everybody does is you steal a napkin that's embossed, whatever it's in. I mean, I'm going to steal anything that isn't nailed down. I mean, not the steering wheel of the plane or the wheels or the landing gear, but everything else is fair game.
I love it. Well, will you tell him hello from Jamie Allman in St. Louis, please? Thank you.
Have you guys ever talked?
Yeah, I've interviewed him. I interviewed him on my TV show, and we actually met him. Denise Schaefer, who is my co-host here, we met him at the rally at the Peabody Opera House right down here in St. Louis when he came to St. Louis. So we had a chance to stand in line and shake his hand.
I will do that. You know, and I can understand people being put off by the public bluster. And I think you'd agree with this. In private, off camera, he is an extremely charming man.
Very. Yeah, I mean,
extremely charming.
Yes, I mean, very easygoing and just as normal as he can be. And, you know, it's funny.
Normal as a 6'4" billionaire can be.
Right. And my 12-year-old son also had the opportunity to meet him when we were at this thing. And my son told him, I hope you become president. And Donald Trump said to him, I hope you become president. I mean, he's just that kind of guy.
Yeah.
So
I will tell you one quick story. So that one of the communications people told me that he took his 12-year-old daughter on the plane for one trip, you know, just to have been during the campaign, to have been on Trump Force One. And he and Trump sort of took delight in this and was showing her around. And at some point she said, "Mr. Trump, do you have a hot tub on this plane?" And he said, "No, we don't. But, you know, maybe we need a hot tub. That's a good idea."
I love it. Well, have fun. And thank you so much for the time. I can't wait to see it.
I'm excited about it. And obviously plenty of news to ask him about.
No doubt about it. We'll see you on Fox News Sunday, brother.
Yep.
Thank you so much.
Jamie.
That's Chris Wallace.